morning so we can get that into. Inshallah, we'll start bit by bit in the topics, inshallah, and we'll get into them. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق خلق الرسل محمد وعلى آله وصحبه التابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. The Quran is a mountain. Again, the mountain expression that we talked last time about the Sharia, for those who were here, as a mountain. And when you stand in front of the mountain, you don't know where to start, but you can at least start to describe the mountain. The Quran is similar in that sense, that it is a huge mountain with many layers and many features and many characteristics of that mountain. But oftentimes, again, as we talked about the Sharia, sometimes we focus on one particular rock on the mountain and leave the rest of the mountain. And we cannot understand that the mountain is a mountain, and we start to approach the mountain properly before looking at the big picture of the mountain. We deal with the Quran oftentimes in a partialistic way, like they call it in philosophy, atomistic way. Like just we look at one verse by one verse when we deal with the Quran. Whether when you memorize the Quran or when you look at the fiqh, the understanding of the Quran, whether the understanding is, as we explained last time, for ethics or for law or for life or for thought, you start by usually looking at a verse of the Quran. In fact, we go even more partial than that. Like often we start with half of a verse or a small part of a verse. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had said this, like just the 4, 5, 6 words of the verse that we would like to quote. And when we memorize and study the Quran, we oftentimes not even look at the verse or even half of the verse. We look at the words, and sometimes even half words. You know, we used to memorize the Quran with the sheikhs, you know, traditional sheikhs. The sheikh will come and tell you, okay, akmil, you know, complete, continue from there. Sometimes the sheikh tells you, okay, read Surah Al-Isra, Surah Al-Nur. And oftentimes the sheikh wants to really, you know, make sure that you memorize very well. So the sheikh starts from half a word, you know. So anulzimuku akmil. Okay, anulzimukumuha wa antum laha karihun wa ya qawmi. So then the sheikh even starts in the middle of the word, not even in the middle of the verse. And that partialistic approach to the Quran is actually very problematic, because the Quran is a book of guidance, and the guidance in the human language is a meaning that has an integrative structure. And the Quran does have a structure. The problem is that we sometimes look at the Quran comparing it with today's literature, wherever we are today in our literature sciences. So we look at the Quran and we think that it has to be divided into chapters and sections and so forth, and where's the index, and where's, like, we look at the book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed as if it is supposed to be divided in, as a thesis is divided in a university. And that is not how the Quran goes. The Quran, yes, is divided into chapters or surahs, but the surahs have different lengths. Some of them have, you know, like 1/10 of the Quran is the whole surah, and the other surahs are like 3 verses, just one line. And every surah is different, and the surahs are ordered in a certain way. You start with a very short surah and then a very long one, and then, you know, the sab'at tawad, you know, the seven long surahs, and then the length varies, and then towards the end, you have short surah, very short surahs, and then all of a sudden, the longer one, al-bayyina, for example, or and then you go back to the shorter ones. There is a wisdom behind the structure of the Quran that we often ignore. So this is the big picture of the mountain. And without a holistic, and they call it in the Ulum al-Quran, in the sciences of the Quran, a thematic or mawdu'i, without a looking at the themes of the Quran, we would not be able to comprehend the Quran. It is true that sometimes a verse implies a hukm. So we read the verse, and there is a hukm, there is a rule, that, but often it's not like that. It's not even the verse that has a hukm. Is usually part of the hukm, because there are other verses that are related to the same verse. Something in the inheritance rules, for example. There are verses that, like other parts of the verse, that talk about wasiyah, about wills. That is related to inheritance. There are other verses that talk about nafaqat, about financial support. That is related to inheritance, and so forth. So if you look at one-fifth of a verse and without understanding the relationship between that part and the rest, without that holistic, integrative approach, then you miss the point. And you end up sometimes with rules that go against the maqasid we talked about last time, against justice and against the freedom of human beings and against free will and everything. This is because you approach the Quran in a partialistic way rather than a holistic way. So in order to approach the Quran in a holistic way, we need to look at the structure of every surah on one hand, and certain meanings, how they are, certain themes, how they are in the whole Quran on the other hand. And that is how we can understand the theme properly. We cannot really understand the theme or a theme in the Quran by looking only at one verse or half a verse. And scholars who really fell into that partialistic methodology or atomistic reductionist, whatever you want to call it in philosophy, methodology, they ended up imagining certain contradictions in the Quran. And the contradictions are not true, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Had it has been revealed from somebody other than Allah, you would have found in it many contradictions. Any human being who writes something that big will have contradictions, because we are humans. Our thoughts are incomplete. So if somebody writes a book that thick, you will find him in one chapter saying something, a different chapter perhaps contradicting. The Quran doesn't have that. Yet, because of the partialistic approach and not looking at the theme, we ended up with a theory that is called abrogation or a naskh in our history. And that theory was expanded beyond, way beyond any reasonable scholarship in the issue of naskh. I will talk about it too as one of the themes of today. Went beyond the issue of different verses for different applications or the gradual application of certain things, and I'll talk about an-naskh, into really imagining something that is not true about the Quran, as if the Quran carries some contradictions. And we humans are supposed to resolve the contradictions by saying that some of the verses are abrogated, are canceled. And some of them are canceled in terms of the rules, but they are still there anyway. We read them, but they are canceled. Kind of theory. That's one approach. And the other one is saying that they are canceled altogether. They are part of the Quran, but they were canceled. And you find some strange narrations that is talking about how they are canceled. You know, one of them, you know, was, you know, it was written on a paper and then it was eaten by, you know, some chicken and all that. Like some stories that really don't make sense about why a verse is canceled from the Quran. So the issue of cancellation or abrogation is the result of not looking at the Quran in a holistic way. Because once you look at the Quran in terms of holistic themes, then you are able to integrate the parts that are apparently contradicting, but they are not contradicting. War does not necessarily contradict with peace, but if you understand war and peace as international relations and two different ways of doing things, then yeah, the verses that talk about war did not contradict with the verses that talk about peace, and you really don't need to abrogate some of them for the sake of the others. The verses that talk about wills, for example, somebody writing a will, does not necessarily contradict with the verses that talk about inheritance laws, because this is something and this is, they don't contradict, they integrate. And we will have to really think about that thematically in terms of the bigger picture and try to understand the issue of abrogation in detail. So I will address that issue in one of the sessions that we have. I would like to address as well the bigger laws that the Quran is presenting for the universe. Again, this as a thematic look at the Quran. The Quran has what's called universals. The universals, kulliyat al-Quran. The universals are actually laws in other philosophies and so on. They are called universal laws. The Quran is calling them as sunan, awl kulliyat. Kulliyat is the scholar's language. As sunan is the Quran's language. Sunan, or the traditions, the general laws that govern the universe, that govern everything, is one of the themes of the Quran that is a very strong theme, very important theme. And it allows us to look at the Quran in its entirety. I will talk about that as well in one or more of the sessions today. Something like diversity, for example. The Quran is mentioning diversity not just in our tongues and colors, but in the plants and in the animals and in religions and in everything, in the colors of the mountains and the tongues of human beings, and everything has diversity. So you'll find almost in every surah that is long enough in the Quran talking about the diversity, for example. That is a theme. That is one of the themes of the Quran that if you take a step back and look, you will find it like a layer that goes from the bottom of the mountain to the top of the mountain. Something that is very clear in the whole mountain as one of the themes of the Quran. So I would like to address this issue of universal laws and how the Quran is presenting them and so forth. First though, I will talk about the thematic. What does it mean to have a thematic interpretation of the Quran? So basically, we're talking about themes first. Oh, sorry. So basically, we're talking about themes in. Talking about themes of the Quran in the beginning, and then we'll talk about themes of surahs. I'll give you some examples of a thematic approach to a surah, to one surah of the Quran. As I said, we often focus on a verse or even half of a verse. Let's look at a surah and how the surah is structured. The surahs are not random. They have a structure. Every surah has a structure. And even if there are different stories, and then it talks about the hereafter, and then it comes back and talks about nature, there is a certain mawdu', there is a certain theme in the surah that when we approach the surah, we need to look at. And of course, this is tafsir. This is not that the Quran is saying this surah has this theme. This is something that the scholars approach the Quran with and scholars who are interested in the thematic approaches of the Quran are able to find some meanings and very important insights. So we'll talk about themes of the Quran. Then we'll talk about the universal laws in the Quran. And I would like to address the issue of obligation with a particular address, because I think that this is part of the partialistic thinking that does not look at the themes. But if you look at the themes, then you are able to integrate what is apparently contradictory in the Quran into themes. There is no contradiction, like serious, real contradiction, as in the contradiction of numbers and so on. Like when you talk about other books, if you look at the Bible, for example, you find that sometimes numbers are contradicting. You know, a count of a certain army. Here is 100,000 and here is like 20,000. Like, one of them has to be wrong. These are numbers. In the Quran, it's not like that, but it is an elusive contradiction. There is no contradiction, but some scholars would come and say, no, that this contradicts with this. I'll give you many examples. And how a thematic look at the Quran would resolve these contradictions, because they are illusions in the mind of some scholars. There is no need to cancel anything in the Quran. And this is something that I would, inshallah, talk about particularly. Themes of the Quran, if I start with this, there are different ways of approaching a thematic interpretation of the Quran. One of them has to do, there are different ways of approaching a thematic interpretation of the Quran. One of them has to do with the theme of every surah, and the other one is a theme across the Quran. So we have the thematic approaches. We have themes within each surah, and we have themes within the whole Quran. These are two approaches of a thematic interpretation, tafsir mawdu'i. There is a mawdu' or a theme for each surah. That is one approach. Scholars bring the surah, put it all there, and then dissect the surah, analyze the surah into a number of themes or a number of stories with something in common between these stories. So that is an integrative way of integrating the whole surah. What is the surah about? And why is this particular surah has so many, for example, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, or that particular surah had so many, like the question, فَبِأَيَّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, and another surah has so many of the mention of this, and how come, and so forth. So they look at one surah, and they try to understand the themes, or one theme, and sometimes a number of themes inside one surah. Okay, that is one approach. The other approach is to look within the whole Quran. We look in the whole Quran for, as we talked, for the universal laws. We look in the whole Quran for the issues related to family, for example. That is a theme. Or to look in the whole Quran for issues related to death and the hereafter. In the whole Quran. And this part is talking about this and this part. And then you start to draw or bring together the pieces of the puzzle to draw the whole picture of one theme within the whole Quran. There are other approaches. Like another approach is focusing on the order. That is also a mawdu'i approach, a thematic approach. Some scholars were interested in the order of the surahs. Like, why do we have Al-Fatiha and then Al-Baqarah and Al-Imran and Al-Nisa and Al-Ma'idah? Like, what is the relationship between the end of the surah and the beginning of the new surah? Why Iqra after Watin wa Zaytun, for example? So they say, for example, Alaysa Allahu bi ahkam al-hakimin, Iqra bism rabbika alladhi khalaq. That once you ask, isn't Allah the most wise? This is the last verse of Surah Zaytun, Teen wa Zaytun. The next verse that comes in the next surah says, Iqra bism rabbika alladhi khalaq. So he is the most wise, therefore read this. In the name of your Lord. So they don't think of this as the surahs as something that cuts the surah from the next surah, But I think, why is the surah coming, why is this coming after this? And then the end of this surah, how it relates to the beginning of the next surah? They think in terms of the order of the surahs. This is another school in the thematic interpretations of the Quran. And all of these themes is the school of thematic, integrative interpretation of the Quran, as I said in the beginning, is something that will take us away from the partialistic and reductionist kind of thinking of the Quran, where we are thinking only about one verse and forgetting the other verses in the same topic and discussing the same issue. Or sometimes, as I said, like half a verse or one third of a verse, half a word sometimes, and we stop there and we try to understand something that is elusive, because it is not in the whole picture. And of course, it is famous in the even the Quran itself is actually talking about that. Is saying, أَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Do you believe in some of the book and reject some? And the famous example in our history, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. Punishment is for those who pray, and while they are praying, they are not focusing. They are busy because they are not focusing. So then we stop. We say punishment for those who pray, for فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ, and we stop there. Kind of. So this is something that actually we do sometimes. It's something that we do sometimes by stopping at one verse, even though فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ is a verse, but it's not enough to take this verse by itself and, you know, and think about it and make the tafsir, because the verse has other verses that complete the meaning, and the Quran is about the meaning. Why did we stop at the verse? Because the Prophet ﷺ have taught the companions where the verses end and begin. This is a way of dissecting the sentences of the Quran in the Wahi for the companions to write and to memorize and to understand. But the verse does not necessarily carry a full meaning. The verse sometimes is one word, mudhammatan. What is mudhammatan? What is this? They are both dark. What is both dark? What are you talking about? If you read before that, yes, he's talking about paradise. There are two gardens. Both of them are dark, not dark, lush. The word in English would be lush green or something, or dark green. They are both dark green. So, فَبِأَيَّ أَلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. So why do you reject your Lord's sign? So, مُدْهَمَّتَان by itself is not enough. Before مُدْهَمَّتَان, there is another verse that talks about part of the meaning. And after مُدْهَمَّتَان, there is another verse that talks about the rest of the meaning. And in fact, if you look at the whole Surah Ar-Rahman, you find that this is part of a bigger picture. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is counting the blessings. Surah Ar-Rahman is about counting blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why after every verse it says, فَبِأَيَّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, which amongst the blessings of your Lord that you reject. And then it talks about something in Jannah. And then, فَبِأَيَّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, and another thing. And then, فَبِأَيَّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ, another thing. And then it talks, before that talks about an-nar, but even hellfire. And then it says, فَبِأَيَّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. In that sense, فَبِأَيَّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ is something that is said to the people of hell, وَالْعَيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, asking them, why did you reject your Lord's signs? So it's the same sentence, but it takes a different meaning, but it's all about the signs and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whether we accept them and thank Him for them or reject them. So that is the whole Surah Ar-Rahman. That is why the whole surah, to start with, started with Ar-Rahman, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ, عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانَ. It started by counting the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is the most merciful. He taught the Quran. This is the first blessing. عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ, He created humans. عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانَ, and taught them language. الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ بِحُسْبَانَ, sun and moons, the sun and the moon are according to a particular order or specific count. وَالنَّجْمُ وَالشَّجَرُ يَسْجُدَانَ, and the star and the tree both prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or in Najmi, the small plant, so a small plant and the large plant all prostrate to Allah. So he is reminding us subhanahu wa ta'ala with the plants and the planets and this and that. And then he starts the theme. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. What of your Lord's signs or ala, not just signs, but blessings, favors, favors. What of your Lord's favors that you reject? And then he goes on, more favors and more favors. So if you understand the surah this way, then it is not a partial understanding. And then you stop at one part and you try to conclude the world, and especially like practical rules and all of that and ethics of Islam from half a verse, and you don't understand the rest of the surah, what it's trying to say. And then you miss the point sometimes. And I will talk about that a lot with under the issue of abrogation, because that is a problem that we have in some of the approaches in our heritage, the approaches of the tafsir, where there are hundreds of verses that were abrogated as if they are there just to, you know, just for the sound of them. And that is not acceptable. And so forth. Okay, so the themes, back to the big picture. The themes, some of them are within each surah. We are trying to understand the surah as a structure. And some approaches to the thematic interpretation of the Quran, talking about themes within the whole Quran, you know, at Tawheed, you know, and so forth, within the whole Quran. And some of the themes focus on the order of the surahs and the order of the verses, and why is this coming before this, and so forth, and why is the end of this surah, how it relates to the beginning of the next surah, and so forth. If I may start with some themes of some surahs as examples, just to give examples from what I read. It's not really mostly my ideas, but from what I read from different scholars and so on. I'm interested in the holistic approaches of Islam and its sources. This is the work that I write on it and do. But the thematic approach is not something I wrote on necessarily, but I read in different places, other than writing, you know, small articles and so on. But I would like to take you through a few examples of thematic approaches within each surah. So take a surah and try to look at the surah. I will assume that you know the surah, or we can bring copies of the Quran if you'd like to flip back and forth through the surah. If you don't memorize it, please, Brother Adam, if you can provide copies for those who want. And that would give us a good way of looking at the surah. If you can find a few copies, or if you have a copy on your iPhone,
can
so
just take
a count.
How many people need copies? One, two,
yeah,
three. Okay, I'll be back.
So if you look, let's start with one of the surahs that we all read. So perhaps we're all familiar with, inshallah, which is Surah Al-Kahf, for example. We all read that surah Friday, inshallah. It's one of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to read Surah Al-Kahf on Friday. And we stop by this surah because, like, again, the question of why we talked about last time. Why do we have to read that surah every week? It must be important. There must be something. You know, why do we read the Fatiha 19 times every day? At least, unless you pray sunnah and tarawih, and then why do you read the Fatiha so many times? Because the Fatiha is important. The themes of the Fatiha are very important. But let's take Surah Al-Kahf. Surah Al-Kahf has, if we analyze it, has four different stories. So if you look at the Surah, Al-Kahf is the cave. And it is Surah number 18, in the just around the middle, in the just 15. Yeah, you will find Surah number 18. So Surah Al-Kahf is the cave. It's named after the people of the cave. who were a number of youth who left their city or town because of oppression of the king, and they went to the cave, took the dog with them, and they stayed in the cave scared and escaping from the people. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them sleep for 300 years and nine, if you calculate in Hijri 309, in solar 300 years. So they slept for 300 years solar, where they were made by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to turn, so they don't basically rot in their sleep. And their turning, eventually they woke up and they went back to their people, and the people discovered that these people were people who disappeared 300 years ago. There was a new king. In fact, the new king was a faithful king, and the people has changed totally. At that time, the king was about to kill them if he had he found that they were believers. So when they came back, they came to the new king. But they did not last with the new king for more than a day, and then they died. So people built a mosque, a mosque or a prayer place close to where they are. So that's the people of the cave. Then the second story is the two friends in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is relating us a story of two friends. One of them is a believer and poor, and the other one is a disbeliever and rich. And the poor believer was telling his friend, قَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ, he told his friend, he was his friend. He told his friend, قَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ, it repeated several times. He told to his friend while they are having dialogue. So it's a friend and it's dialogue, and it's repeating itself to really focus. So I would comfortably give a title, Two Friends, Dialoguing, if you wish. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran how he told his friend while he is in dialogue with him. Why do you disbelieve and so on? And his friend told him, no, I insist on my disbelief, and if I go to my Lord, I will have a better garden and a better river and a better everything. So a storm came, or a hurricane or something, and the garden became like total ashes. So he regretted and returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So basically, it is the story of the believer friend who is poor trying to convince the disbeliever friend who is rich, while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given the rich friend at the end a trial or a calamity that made him return to faith. The third story is the story of Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Musa and Al-Khadr, Abd, yani the Quran is saying the servant of Allah. So it is Musa, who is the prophet of Ulil Azm, of the prophets with high will, like the five top prophets really we have in the Quran. Fasbir kama sabara ulul azm min ar-rusul, ulul azm, the prophets of will, the prophets of force, the power prophets in the American way. So they are, so Musa was one of them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he had a story with Al-Khadr, who was a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Most scholars say that he was not a prophet or anything, but he had knowledge that Musa did not have. So Musa was basically humbling himself to that person in order to learn from him. And then Khadr had done a number of things by destroying a certain ship, and then killing a young man, and then he did certain things that Musa did not understand with his basic knowledge and knowledge that of the situations. So he objected, and Al-Khadr told him, no, you learn and you don't object, and I will explain later, so and so forth. The fourth theme is Dhul-Qarnayn. Dhul-Qarnayn, and some people are saying that he is Alexander the Great, or basically another king, whatever, but he's a king, the king, the story of the king. إِنَّا مَكَّنَّا لَهُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَبَبًا. We gave him a lot of authority on earth, and we gave him means for everything. Like, he was a very, very powerful king. Now, if you look at that surah thematically, you will see that this is the story of belief, story of Iman, in different forms. Take a seat, inshallah. And if you need a copy of the Quran, please ask for look at that surah al-Kahf. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is relating to us a number of surah, a number of stories. All of them have the theme of Iman, of belief, right? But belief in different forms. This is a belief of a people who had to hide from a tyrant and die. Simple as that. And yes, they woke up 300 years later when the tyrant was gone and everybody was a believer. But this is the story of Iman, when Iman had to hide and die. And that is that's something that happens in history. The other surah At-Tariq, قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُخْدُودِ النَّارِ ذَاتُ الْوَقُودِ, the people who are believers, and the king put them in fire and they died. I mean, Iman does not necessarily always have victory. That is something that the Quran is teaching us. Sometimes it does, sometimes it gets defeated, simple as that. And everybody dies. So this is a surah, this is a story that is giving us one form of Iman, of belief. If you look at the second form, this is a form of belief in which the believer is making da'wah, is trying to get to the other person. It's a more, let's say, more successful story of Iman. On the earthly level, like, this is also a great success, but they died and the disbelievers died as disbelievers. Nobody entered Islam or any of this. But in this surah, the friend who is a believer is telling the disbeliever about Allah and so on. And then the disbeliever was lucky enough to have this calamity that burnt his gardens. So while he was alive, فَأَصْبَحَ يُقَلِّبُكَ فَيَّ عَلَى مَا أَنْفَقَ فِيهَا وَهِيَ خَوَيَّةٌ عَلَى رُشِيَةٍ وَيَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي لَمْ أُشْرِكْ بِرَبِّي أَحَدًا. So he woke up in the morning and he found the carnage and everything. So he was shaking his head and clapping his hands and saying, I regret associating other lords with my Lord, رَبِّي. Which means that he converted to belief at the end. So this is a story of Iman that did not die in the cave. No, it's a story of Iman that went out and did convince people, or another person in that sense, to believe. So this is a story of da'wah that is a successful story. If you go to the next story, this is a story of Iman that was trying to make a change on the ground, which is, in this case, Al-Khadr. And Musa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, needed to learn this lesson, even though he was a prophet from the top prophets, as we explained. He needed to learn this lesson, that Iman, sometimes belief, needs to take action, not just with tongue and da'wah, but an action on the ground. This is a story of Iman doing reform. So, for example, the first of the three stories within the story of Musa and Al-Khadr, when Al-Khadr destroyed the ship, and Musa told him, why do you do that? Eventually, he told him, I'm destroying it because there is a king who comes and takes every good ship from the people. So I'm making a hole in that ship so that the poor people keep their ship, because when the king will come, the king. So this is a story of a believer, Al-Khadr, or the servant of Allah, as the Quran named him. It's just the tafsir that says Al-Khadr. So the servant of Allah had known from the trail of that king that the king is arriving soon and the king will take that ship. So he made a hole in the ship. This is an action of a believer. The servant of Allah as well killed a young man. Ghulam is not a child. Ghulam is a young man. So he was a person, not simply a child. And in that sense, the justice had ordained that this young man is to be killed. And perhaps he killed other people, perhaps whatever happened, the details are not given by the surah. But this is not the servant of Allah killing a child. It's not like that, as we understand in the colloquial Arabic, ghulam. Some people don't differentiate between the ghulam and the tifl. A tifl is a child, the ghulam is a young man. So that young man who was killed, so that he's not a tyrant with his parents, or he was a tyrant with his parents, the servant said, this is also belief in action, including action like that. And then also belief in action, building that wall that Musa, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they asked the people to feed them, they didn't want to feed them, but there was a wall that was attempting to fall. The Quran is saying, yuridu an yanqad, the wall was trying to fall. So the servant of Allah put the wall back and made it fine, in a good shape. And the wisdom behind that was a treasure under that wall that some children of a pious man will find eventually. And then the servant of Allah said, وَمَا فَعَلْتُهُ عَنْ أَمْرِي, I did not do this out of my own initiative. So it was a revelation. That's why some people say he was a prophet, because it was a revelation that there is a treasure under this wall, and these kids who own this place, when they grow up and discover the treasure, will be good for them because their father was a pious man, etc. So regardless of the tiny details, this is iman in an ascension order here from the story of iman or belief dying in a cave, to the story of belief succeeding in making da'wah, to the story of belief succeeding in making a change on the ground by making specific actions to a ship, to a wall, to and so forth on the ground. And this is the story of iman in the form of kingship. This is a king who is a believer. So this is kind of the height of a story of belief, where there is the belief here was oppressed and died. The belief here was able to break ground by dialogue. The belief here was able to do some action in the society. And the belief here is the belief of a king who ruled the world. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that Dhul-Qarnayn, or the king with the two horns, like, or with not literal horns, but with something that he wore with two horns on it. That's why some people say it was Alexander the Great. He was famous of this kind of hat, but could be anything. And you notice that the Quran doesn't care about names and places. This is not the issue. It's not the issue in the Quran. The issue is the theme. It gives us the names of the prophets usually. وَرُسُلًا قَدْ قَصَصْنَاهُمْ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَرُسُلًا لَمْ نَقْصُصْهُمْ عَلَيْكَ. Allah is saying that we gave you the names of some prophets, and some prophets we did not give you their stories even, or their names for that matter. And some stories with a description. Al-Kifli, for example, the man with the shawl. That's it. This is a prophet. Some people say Buddha, some people say whatever, but he was a man with a shawl, and that's it. So and people don't really sometimes know the name from the Quran. Yet, the Quran is interested in the content and the theme. So therefore, we don't know where the people of the cave were. We don't know where the cave is. Some people are theorizing that it is Jordan, or it is somewhere in Turkey, or whatever, a cave in Iraq. And the Quran itself is mentioning this, that people will say they were three, and their fourth person was the dog, and they were five, and they were seven. فَرَبِّي أَعْلَمْ غَيْدَتِمْ. Allah knows the number. So whether the people of the cave, if we imagine them, were five, or were seven, or were three, or were 21, or were 50, it doesn't matter. This is not the point. The Quran is itself in the surah is telling us that the numbers are not important, let alone the name of the king and where the cave was. Was it in Turkey or in Jordan and all of these national countries that we created now and we think in terms of it's irrelevant. This is irrelevant. The land is all for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the caves are all His. But this is the story of belief when the believers hid in a cave until they died. And this is the story of da'wah, and this is the story of activism and action on the ground, kind of an activist story here. And here is the story of the believer king who was with any just cause. He built that wall from iron in order to protect the people. قالوا إذا قلنا يأجوج ومأجوج مفسدون في الأرض. They complained to him that Ya'juj and Ma'juj, also two tribes, we don't know their names, we don't know where they are. Some people say China, some people say whatever. They were attacking us, and we want to give you whatever you ask for so that you protect us. So he made a wall, basically an iron wall. فَمَسْتَعُوا أَيَظَهُرُوا وَمَسْتَطَعُوا لَهُ نَقْبًا. So the army could not climb the wall and could not make a hole in the wall. So he protected the people of that city. So he was a king who was good, using all his power in order to protect the oppressed and all of that. And he traveled the east and the west, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that in the Quran, and ruled the world. So this is the story of the belief. That is why the end of the surah, if you think about it thematically, it talks about الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا عَمْلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. That is why it is very fitting to have the last four verses, which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave, you know, specific rewards for those who memorize the last four verses of Surah Al-Kahf. And if you read them before you sleep and you decide to wake in a certain time, you will wake in that time. And all of these hadith about Surah Al-Kahf, towards the end, it says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ نُزُلْ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا لَا يَبْغُونَ عَنْهَا حِوَلًا. So it talks about those who believe and do good deeds. Whether those who believe and do good deeds were people of the cave, or somebody who is calling somebody for Islam or for belief, or it is somebody who is trying to be active in making things happen on the ground to protect the oppressed and to be kind to all the people and so on, or it is the king who is also aman wa amilu salihat, also a believer and did good deeds. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, those who believe and do good deeds, كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ نُزُلًا, they are all in heaven. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا, they are all there forever, everlasting. لَا يَبْغُونَ عَنَا حِوَلًا, and they never think of any other alternative. قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ الْبَحْرُ مِدَادًا لِكَلِمَاتِ رَبِّي. Had more fitting to read the translation now. So if the sea, if the ocean were ink, where is to write out the words of my Lord, sooner would the ocean be exhausted than would the words of my Lord, even if we added another ocean like it for its aid. And then قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم, say I am but a man like yourselves, with the inspiration coming to me that your Allah is one God. Whoever expects to meet his Lord, let him work righteousness, and in the worship of his Lord admit no one as a partner. So this is very fitting for the end of the surah to sum all of this. In any shape or form that iman, that belief takes, it is a shape or form in which this applies. People go to heaven, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a wisdom, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words, kalimat, words, but words of wisdom really, can fill like ocean full of ink would not exhaust the words of wisdom of Allah, even if we bring another ocean and so forth. And therefore, فَلْيَعْمَلْ, the last order is then let whoever believes in Allah work. فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا, let him or her do righteous deeds. وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعْبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا, and do not associate anybody with your Lord. Do not associate anybody with your Lord and do good deeds applies if you are similar to that case where you are hiding in a cave, or you are similar to that case where you are inviting neighbors and friends and so on in a community that's dealing with other disbeliever communities, or you are in that case where you are a believer who's taking his or her activism to the action on the ground, whatever the action is, or you are in that case where you are a believer and ruling the world and you are doing some good deeds. In this case, we can see the surah as a whole, and of course between the stories, there are some mention of the hereafter. Between the first and second story, there is a mention of those who reject إِنَّ أَعْتَدْنَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ نَارًا أَحَاطَ بِهِمْ سُرَادِقُهَا وَإِنْ يَسْتَغِيثُوا يُغَاثُوا بِمَاءٍ كَالْمُهْلِ يَشْوِي الْوُجُوهَ, and so forth. So there is mention of the hereafter and the punishment in hell and reward in paradise, but as really between brackets, interceding kind of sentences between the stories to link the stories. If we look at the surah this way, then there are many benefits from doing that. The least and most direct of them is in the memorization. You know, I was not able to memorize that surah until I looked at it this way. Okay, cool. Okay, well, because I used to go from this to here, and then I forget the two friends. And I said, okay, so why is the two friends between and so the cave story and the Musa's story? Okay, so basically, yeah, this is somewhere more successful and more like a brighter picture than the picture of the people who died in the cave. Okay, so I remember that after the people of the cave, then the two friends, and then the story of Musa, and then at the end, it is the story of the king. So kind of an ascension, kind of. It helps you with memorization. It helps you with understanding the general themes. As I'm saying, sometimes we take half a verse, half a word, and we stop at that when we try to understand Islam through that, and that is not correct. We need to look at the integrative, holistic meaning. And if you look at these meanings, you will also understand a lot of ahkam. There is a mistake that some people made in the fiqh with naming what they called ayat al-ahkam, the verses of the rules, as if 300 or 400 of the verses of the Quran, they have different counts, are the verses of the rules, and everything else is entertainment. But actually, there are rules in the ethical sense and in the legal sense, as we talked last time. In the ethical sense and the legal sense, everywhere in the Quran, in every story of the Quran, there are rules. Not that the story is for entertainment. So we understand rules from here, for example. We understand the rules of necessity and the rules of, you know, hiding sometimes with your belief. And perhaps a rule of you know, having a dog or something, as Imam Malik mentioned. Like it's not haram or any of that. Well, scholars would debate whether, again, abrogation, whether Islam had abrogated the previous faiths in that. Other rules of, you know, going in secret in a place and perhaps lying for the fear of your life and so on. وَلَا تَلَطَّفْ وَلَا يُشْعَرَنَّ بِكُمْ أَحَدًا. Just say good words to them. Don't say the truth. Don't say where we are, etc. There are rules here about da'wah and dialogue. So, قَالَهُ صَحِبُ. First of all, to have a friend who is non-Muslim, that is a rule here. قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ. The Quran, Allah is saying he's his friend. You know, who am I to say no? You cannot have a friend who is non-Muslim. Because Allah is saying that he is telling his friend. قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ وَهُوَ يُحَاوِرُهُ. And then you make da'wah with hiwar, with dialogue. So some people are against that principle. No, da'wah is not with dialogue. But Allah is saying he told his friend why they're having the dialogue. So this is a hukm here for you. And so the da'wah could be with dialogue. Here is another more activist kind of person who goes and you know, breaks a ship and does this and does all of these operations for the sake of iman. This is also another look at the ahkam of al-maslaha wal-mafsada, you know, the good and the mischief. And sometimes you have to weigh different mischiefs and you take the least harm and so forth. All these rules of the least harm and the bigger good and so on is mentioned here in Surah Al-Kahf, in the servants of Allah's works, because these things are not haram that he did. He just did them out of maslaha and mafsada, you know, what is best and the least harm and the most good. And as well, here is a king who also is giving us rules on how to deal with the oppressed, to protect them and so on. He did not go and fight with that oppressive army, but he tried to protect the community that was oppressed, and so forth. He was seeking knowledge in beyond the horizons. He was traveling for the sake of knowledge and for the sake of spreading the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all of that. So we can also look at the surah in terms of ahkam as well, in terms of rules and ethics of Islam, not just in terms of entertainment. And you can take ahkam from that, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not praise in his book something that is haram, and will not mention something that is unlawful, and that is against the fundamentals of Islam. So when you look at the stories, also stop at some of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning and reflect upon them in terms of ahkam as well. So memorization is one of the wisdoms behind looking at the themes this way. Al-ahkam as well, the looking at the ethics and the rules that you can get from the Quran, as well as a very important ibadah, which is tafakkur, you know, the reflection. أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ عِنْدِي غَيْرِ اللَّهِ أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ عِنْدِي غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Don't they reflect upon the Quran? Allah is always telling us, reflect upon the Quran. This is ibadah in its own right. And reflecting upon the Quran will make us understand things. إِلَّا فَهْمًا أُتِيهِ رَجُلٌ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Imam Ali رضي الله عنه, when he was asked about the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that he narrated, they asked him, okay, is this the end of knowledge? He said, no, the end of knowledge could be somewhere in the future, with an understanding that a man gets from the book of Allah. So the companions of the Allah understood that the Quran is an open book. The tafsir did not finish by the companions of the Allah anhum, let alone by Ibn Kathir or al-Tabari or al-Razi or al-Jassaf. This is not the end of tafsir. The tafsir is open. And every believer, man or woman, is able to look at the Quran and understand something. إِلَّا فَهْمًا أُوتِيهِ الرَّجُلٌ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. Somebody who will come in the future might understand something that Imam Ali, we're talking about Imam Ali رضي عنه, مدينة العلم. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَنَا مَدِينَةُ الْعِلْمِ وَعَلِيٌّ بَابُهَا. I am the city of knowledge and Ali is its door. And so forth. So he is the door of the city of knowledge, according to the Prophet's poetic way of describing him. Yet he said, well, I understand things from the book of Allah, that sometimes a man who will come in the future will understand more things. So this kind of approach of the Quran will keep the Quran open to understanding and to projection on your time. Because now you can project, I'm like these people of the cave, therefore maybe I could think this way or do this, or I am like this king who rules the world. Maybe then I can learn some lessons from that king's story and all of that. So that the Quran is open, and with the change of place and time, history and geography, then we can learn more and read more into the Quran that people previously did not read. Not because they were deficient, it's just because the change of place and time put us in new situations and new circumstances. And now we can start to understand. That's one of the wisdoms also behind looking at the themes in the surah rather than focusing on a verse or half a verse or half a word, as I was saying. Let me stop this and get your comments and reflect here.
Did the Prophet
do tafsir with the Sahaba? Actually, very little. Very little. He explained some of the meanings of the verses when he was asked. But he did not give them lessons in tafsir. I think the intent behind that is to keep the Quran open. So he did not sit with the companions and take the Quran as some of the imams do or did over time. Here's the Fatiha and here's the tafsir. Here's what Allah is talking about. That is what it means here. Because the Arabic structure of the Quran is always kept open. It's very rarely very, very definite in the Arabic language. It's always kept open. So that you can understand the same words in different times in different ways. So the Prophet ﷺ, sometimes he was asked, for example, الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ. There is a verse that says, those who believe and do not commit injustice will have security, and they are the guided ones, security in the hereafter. So the companions went to him and told him, we will never have security in the hereafter. He said, why? He said, they said, because we always commit injustices. And Allah said, الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ. Those who believe and did not mix their belief with injustice. He said, no, this is not the injustice that you make. It is the injustice of al-kufr, of disbelief. So when somebody is a disbeliever, he is making an injustice. So he's saying, no, injustice, al-dhulm huwa al-kufr. Injustice means kufr, not necessarily what you understand. So he kind of corrected an erroneous understanding. The man who went to him and in Ramadan, and he had a white thread and a black thread, and he was staring at that. So Prophet ﷺ told him, what are you doing? He said, because the verse is saying, وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيْنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. And so drink and eat until you see the white thread from the black thread of the dawn. So he is saying, that's why I have a white thread and a black thread, and he's staring at them. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, no, this is the white thread and the black thread in the sky, not in your hands. Like, so he sometimes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, corrected erroneous tafsirs. When the companions take the tafsir and they go in a certain way, literally. So because the Arabic word is khayt, thread. The white thread, until the white thread reveals itself from the black thread. So the companions at that time literally thought that they're talking about threads, like a white thread and a black thread. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, told them, no, this is the white thread and black thread in the sky. So once you start to see the light, then you stop eating and drinking, and this is dawn. And by the way, it's not a very definite minute or anything. By the way, it is like there are different opinions and different ways, and it's a period by which you have to stop at some point. So anyway, so a few minutes after, a few minutes before is all right. You know, it's not a fatwa, but just what I know about this matter. So the Prophet ﷺ sometimes corrected erroneous tafsirs. But he never sat with the companions, thought, okay, Surah Al-Baqarah, this and that. No. And when he has a new verse, Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he tells them, put this verse before this and after that. Put this verse after that surah, that verse that talked about so in Surah So. So they go and they put the verse in that order. So he gives them the order only, but he did not give them a specific tafsir.
Different tafsir were written at different times, as you mentioned, like you know, Ibn Abbas, this was some earlier years, and then Tabari and all those. For us, you know, as students that sometimes are not comfortable, that, you know, because of the lack of knowledge, do you have any recommendations in mind where we can reflect but not go astray, you know, if we're just reading ourselves and making our own themes of different, you know, rather than following something and then opening our mind to what somebody has already reflected upon.
Well, okay. Well, I would have two humble recommendations here. The first of them is to understand the different schools of tafsir. If you're interested in tafsir, there are different schools, not just one way. Ibn Kathir is from the school that's called a tafsir bil athar, the tafsir based on the narration. So schools of tafsir. One of them is the narration based tafsir is a tafsir that looks for whatever hadith, as our sister was asking, whatever the Prophet ﷺ said about the verses, and they mention it, or asbab al-nuzul, what's called the reasons behind the revelation. Not the exact reasons, but the occasions. Asbab is the occasion rather than the reason. It's not the reason, we don't know the reason, but we know the occasion. So asbab al-nuzul means the occasions behind the revelations. So they look at the occasions, and they look at the hadith, and they look at the companions commented on the verses. All al-athar, all the narration. So this is one school of the tafsir. Ibn Kathir and Tabari, I would say, and so on. They fall under most of the tafsirs that you have. There is a narration base. There is a fiqh based school of tafsir, where the scholars approaching the Quran in terms of fiqh, in terms of rules or ethics. So they approach everything in terms of that kind of tafsir. So that is, and you should read from all of them, not just the narration, but also the fiqh tafsir. There is the linguistic tafsir. I don't remember the different names now. I don't recall them, but some of the tafsirs, was it the Makhshari or like one of the Mufassirin,
Shawkani.
And Shawkani is mixing the fiqh and the language, but the language is strong as well. So some scholars start with the language. They tell you, okay, this comes after this, and this is the verb, and this is the adjective. They look at the Quran in a linguistic way. There is a what's called a Sufi tafsir, where it is about experience, and people give you a tafsir from their own wijdan, you know, their own experience, self-experience kind of thing. So some of the Sufis who approached the Quran in a tafsir, they gave us a tafsir by their own spiritual experience with the Quran. And there is a historic tafsir, where people look at the Quran in terms of history, whether the history of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muhammad, or the history of the other prophets or history of other nations, and they approach the tafsir in this historical way, in a milal wa nihal, ibn hazm kind of way, where they compare the history of the different people and how these went astray and how these did not go astray and so forth. There is a tafsir that is a scientific tafsir, and this is rather modern, where people look at the science, tafsir al-ilmi. You know, they look at the science, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that the sun is a lamp and the moon is a reflection. That is very accurate. He mentioned in Surah Ar-Rum that the Romans were defeated in the lowest land. Yes, it is the lowest point on earth, etc. The two seas have a line between them. Yes, it is the sea of this and that. So the kind of tafsir, the creation of an embryo in a womb, and so forth and so forth. So they take a scientific tafsir, and that is the angle of science. And of course, the problem here is that science changes. So sometimes you take a scientific look, like Ustad Muhammad Abdul, Imam Muhammad Abdul, when he wrote in his tafsir things about al-jinn, for example. In his time, late 19th century, science was too proud of itself. It did not think that there is anything beyond what could be proven in a lab. So he said, well, if jinn goes against science, then yeah, jinn is the bacteria and the wind and so on. There's nothing called jinn. These are all the forces of nature. Kind of. That's a tafsir. Now we know it's wrong, because we know now that there is something beyond the ultraviolet and before the infrared, many things, in fact. We are very, very limited in terms of sound and vision. But the scientific tafsir has its limitations, but it's important for da'wah and all of that. Some people convert to Islam when they see how accurate the Quran is.
What does Al-Razi
suppose? Al-Razi, I don't remember, to be honest. I don't remember, but I remember a very linguistic like strength in tafsir Al-Razi. But there is a lot of fiqh as well. I don't remember. Haven't read the traditional tafsir for a long time. And that is my second recommendation, which is to read the modern tafsirs. Because the modern tafsirs give you today's reflection upon the Quran. And a scholar who sits and writes a tafsir, like Sheikh Sha'rawi or Ma'ashur or whoever, the Sheikh Al-Ghazali wrote a tafsir, thematic tafsir, or Sheikh Said Hawa, like somebody who sits and writes a new tafsir, say, in the 20th century, is somebody who is really heavy. Like, not every student of knowledge will sit and write a tafsir of the whole Quran. So every one of those tafsirs will give you something new of the 20th century. So I would recommend to mix the narration-based tafsir with the modern tafsirs, because the narration-based tafsir will give you, what the Prophet ﷺ said, if any, about every verse, and what the companions said, if any, and so forth. Yeah, very basic information. Just in case you are surprised about one of the verses and so on, it tells you, well, the occasion when this verse was revealed was this and that. Plus modern tafsirs, because modern tafsirs, not just the scientific tafsir, but in general, they link, like if you read Fi Dhilal al-Qur'an, in the shadows of the Qur'an, of Sayyid Qutb, for example, you will find him linking the verses of the Qur'an with the modern times, and tyrants, and dictatorships, and so on. He was a revolutionary, as you might know, and therefore, he's talking about changing the world to towards freedom, but the true freedom, which is worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He reflects upon these things this way. He approaches Surah Al-Anfal wa Tawbah that talks about battles of Uhud and so forth with a fresh look at the 20th century's battles and how people kill each other and how this and that. And then they give something about the Sunan, Sunan al-Ilahiyya. They talk about the themes of the universal laws, which I'll talk about today as well as mentioned in the beginning, and so forth. So the modern day tafsirs, Ibn Ashur was the Imam of Zaytuna in Jam' al-Zaytuna in Tunis. In the 20th century, his tafsir is called the Tahrir wa Tanwir, the liberation and enlightenment, with a very interesting name of a tafsir. So he, in his Tahrir wa Tanwir, it's actually traditional, but he is giving a lot of insights in terms of Maqasid. And so he was a scholar of Maqasid, his book on Maqasid Sharia is very famous. So he would give a very insightful look at some of the verses and so on and so forth. So basically, look at the schools of tafsir, read from every school, but focus on the modern tafsirs, which will give you kind of a fresh look at today's reflections on the Quran. But you would not go astray or anything if you try to reflect yourself upon the Quran. I mean, you're not giving any fatwas, right, or any of this. So there, like, every Muslim has the duty, in fact, to look at the Quran and try to resonate with some of the meanings of the Quran. The Prophet ﷺ did not make the tafsir let's put it this way, a profession that is monopolized. Every Muslim at the time of the Prophet ﷺ reflected upon something and understood something from the Quran. And if it is not really off, he would approve it and he would encourage it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is perhaps one of the reasons, as the sister's question, when that he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not give tafsir to every verse. He left it because the Quran is different. The Quran is meant to be open and meant to be left open for the tafsirs to come century after century and do renewal. And that is why this thematic tafsir is a way of renewing the look at the Quran. Perhaps people before did not think in terms of themes, did not think in terms of running themes throughout big corpuses of literature in general, in the human sense. But now we need to think in terms of that, because if we look at the partial verse or half a word, as we were saying, that's when people go astray, when they look at half of the verse or a single verse and they don't look at the whole theme or what the Quran is saying about the whole topic. See?
Regarding the theme approach, the universal theme, Kuliyat, was it derived through a certain methodology, or for example, the Fatiha has sometimes translated as the opening chapter? You know, they use that as a key for universal themes throughout the Quran.
How did they come about with that? Well,
yeah, that discussions, a consensus, or things like that, amongst scholars, tafsir.
What do you mean? You mean what is the methodology of
these universal themes?
Okay.
Right, like you had mentioned that there obviously is not mentioned in a surah, this is the universal theme. There's a certain way of arriving at these themes.
Well, by induction, by surveying the different themes, and then you can bring the universal themes to the fore, like the induction. Induction in the ancient sense is questioning a yes or no for each of the cases and so forth. Induction in the modern holistic sense is a sense where the new meaning emerges from the details. If you look at all the details, you find that the meaning is emerging. So for example, I said I would talk about the universal laws and diversity, for example. You see that from the different verses of the Quran, there is the word ikhtilaf. Ikhtilaf, ikhtilaf al-layl wa ikhtilaf al-sinatikum wa al-manikum, and so forth. So the word ikhtilaf, the word diversity, or the word difference, is mentioned in many places. So from that, you can come up with a theme, which is diversity, or differences, or tanawwa. And then you look at what kind of tanawwa, then you go back, and you look at what kind of tanawwa is there, what kind of differences are there. okay, yes, there are differences in the races and the tongues and religions, and oh, there's a difference here of opinions, and there is another difference of this, and then you go back and forth. So induction in the modern sense is a survey by which you leave the Quran to talk about itself, like you leave the phenomena, to speak philosophically, to leave the phenomena itself to present itself to you, rather than assuming a phenomena and reading it in the kitab itself, in the book. I don't know if it makes sense. But what is there, dalil? No, sometimes it is just an ijtihad. There is no dalil for that. It's just a way of looking at things in an ijtihad. Well, no, I think that the historic perspective is very important before the what you call Sufi, or if you mean the personal experience kind of thing with the
right.
Quran. No,
right.
Before you have your personal journey with the Quran, you need to look at the traditional tafsirs that tell you, you know, at least the general meanings of the words, the general occasions of revelation of the verses, and so on. Because the experience is not supposed to take the Quran so far. You know, some people, they say, okay, I'm going to deal with the Quran with my own experience. And then they come up with a rule or sometimes an understanding that is so off that nobody had ever thought of. And the language doesn't really bear. Like, it might, but it's too far and so forth. And that is one of the deviated schools of tafsir, the tafsir al-Batini, one of the schools of tafsir. There were Bataniya, people who, the inner truth kind of people in our Islamic history. And the Bataniya, that's what they did. They read the Quran in a very, very different way that deviated the Quran from every meaning there is. So when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, like for example, the verse that says, وَلَكِنْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمَ النَّبِيِّينَ, the Prophet is the seal of the prophets. Everybody understands that the seal of the Prophet is the last Prophet. And this is mentioned in a number of other hadiths too. And it's something that every Muslim knows, that Prophet Muhammad is the seal of the Prophets in the sense of being the last Prophet. They read, وَخَاتَمْ النَّبِيِّينَ means that the essence of the Prophets, or something like that. They kind of twisted the Arabic word in order to mean that instead of the seal of the Prophets, he's the perfume of the Prophets. He is so he is the khatam. It's basically, yeah, the essence of the Prophets. So they say, therefore, we could have prophets after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then they ended up with this prophet and that prophet and so on. So they use the tafsir in order to open a new religion that is not Islam anymore. So that is something that is very dangerous in the Sufi tafsir, in that sense, in the tafsir of the inner experience and so forth, even if it is something that nobody had ever came up with. That's different from a new ijtihad. There is new ijtihad within the very, very general boundaries of the language and of the historical facts and so on. Now we can have new ijtihad. But a new ijtihad that simply relies on the very, very basic meanings of the Arabic words, is not something that then you open the Quran to the people's whims and the people's desires. You know, you read very, very funny tafsirs sometimes. People just read something and they want to open the Quran for their own desire. Like, for example, I was reading the other day about somebody who read in Surah An-Nisa, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَكِحْمَ فَضَلَكُمْ نِسَاءِ مَثْنَا وَثُلَاثَ وَرُبَاعَ, marry two or three or four, مَثْنَا وَثُلَاثَ وَرُبَاعَ. So in the Arabic it says two and three and four. So he actually added that. He said 2 + 3 + 4 is 9. So therefore, a man can marry 9 wives, not 4. So, and you see a lot of this in the world of tafsir. There is a lot of deviated tafsir that went with the impression rather than being grounded in the history. So therefore, I was telling my brother to start with the narration-based tafsir bil-athar to really kind of guide you. You might have a new reflection, but because you know that the occasion was this and the hadith that commented on that verse is saying so, therefore you will not go so far with the tafsir.
Just about the narration-based, are the hadith that are in the narration-based, are they
all
sahih, or are they just everything?
Well, it depends on the tafsir itself. It really depends. In fact, in the narration-based, there are a number of there is kind of openness to anything that has to do with the verses that were said, including sometimes a hadith da'ifa, including sometimes Israelites in the tafsir. Like you see a lot in the tradition of tafsirs, things that were from the traditions of the people of the book. So this is not confirmed information. So we find a lot of that. And that is a problem because it did affect the Islamic narration of many of the stories that the Quran insists on not giving details about. But we go to the people of the book and insist on finding the details, as we mentioned in Surah Al-Kahf. How many people and what was the city called, and where is the mountain and where is the cave and all of that. And some of this is correct information, but many of it is not. And many of it is wrong. Like once you get into the Bible stories and compare them to the Quranic stories, there are basic differences between the Bible stories and the Quranic stories. Yes, there are similarities. But from the story of Adam on, for example, the Bible blames Eve for the sin. But the Quran doesn't. In fact, the Quran blames Adam for the sin. That is a fundamental story. So if you copy from that story, you will realize that you are becoming anti-women. You're blaming the Bible stories that talked about the prophet's sins, the sin of David and the sin of Noah and all of that, and prophets, you know, getting drunk and raping and killing and doing everything like this kind of thing. Once you have some of this kind of finds its way to the tafsirs, in this, then there's something wrong here, because no, we believe that the prophets were protected from all moral sins. They are examples. No prophet is supposed to, you know, get drunk or kill somebody, let alone no average Muslim would do that, let alone a prophet, you see, and so forth. So yeah, the tafsir of narration is important, but you be careful with what is in there if you are really going to get yourself. Yes, sir.
Possible to talk about the importance of knowledge of Arabic in order to study Quran. The reason I'm asking that is, for instance, the verse you mentioned in Surah Kahf about the two friends. So the word used, the Sahaba, Sahaba, is
Qala Sahibi. Yeah.
But then we have another verse where it says specifically, do not take as Wali. Now, in English, both of them are translated as friend.
Yeah.
Right? So, and of course, English falls apart and it can't. Because Sohra and Wali are two completely, you know,
yeah,
two different types of friends. So, yeah, how important is that?
Yeah, it is extremely important. It is, and thank you for reminding me, because I didn't stress it enough. Perhaps I forgot that I'm speaking in English and in the States here. Yeah, it is incredibly important that when you approach the Quran, that your Arabic is good enough to do that. If you're going to approach it and for your personal reflections and all of that. Because if you don't know the difference between Sahib and Wali, then there is a problem. When you have the language skill, then you could not focus on one verse, because if your Arabic is not good, you will spend all your time with one, you will spend a day to understand three verses and so on. And then you will not have time to go to other parts of the Quran that talk about the same topic. So for example, the topic of believers and disbelievers and awliya and friends and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in the different verse, لَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ عَنْ الَّذِينَ لَمْ يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ وَلَمْ يُخْرِجُوكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ أَنْ تَبَرُّوهُمْ. Allah doesn't forbid you from those who did not fight with you for the sake of your religion or drive you out of your homes. أَنْ تَبَرُّوهُمْ, so that to be kind to them, or the word bir, which is, you know, bir al-walidain, to be kind to parents, bir. The word bir is the highest kindness in Islam. إِنَّ اللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ, and Allah loves those who are just. So kindness and friendship, and then you can put wali in the correct sense of supporting in a war sense, or supporting in a sense that compromises the truth or compromises other believers and all of that. I'm saying that the language of Arabic and the language of the whole Quran is very important before you approach that, because you cannot know one or two surahs or memorize one or two surahs or even memorize the whole Quran and your Arabic is not that good, and then you start to do reflections and think about themes. That is unacceptable. Unless you look at the translation and you try to, you know, reflect upon the meanings that are confirmed, really. We're not talking about specific words here. You know, the Prophet Musa ﷺ did that, the Prophet Shu'aib did that. That is on a very different level from going to the verses and the words and try to see, okay, قَالَ لَهُ صَاحِبُهُ, so that's his friend, that's different. So yes, it is very important. And learning Arabic is not very difficult for those of you who are not Arab speaking. For those of you who are not Arab speaking, learning Arabic is not very difficult, because you learn a language and you start to understand it. It is a 10-15 year journey in order to get, you know, a very good command of the language. But you know, from my own experience with English, for example, I don't know, 20 years ago, when I migrated to Canada, I didn't speak any English. So I really had a hard time understanding anything that is said in a classroom or in a gas station even. I couldn't function. Even though I could read and write, you know, basic. But then eventually it is the matter of dealing with the language and really spending time with it and so forth. And then you are able to reflect upon. You don't have to be born Arab or your name is Arabic in order to reflect, but you have to have a good command of English, like a really proper command. I'm amazed sometimes by, you know, Yusuf Ali or Muhammad Asad or these people who are not born Arab and they learned Arabic later in their lives, but with their translation, I see sometimes they capture meanings that most Arabs wouldn't see, you know, in the language. So they really, really capture the meaning. But then Muhammad Asad's translation, for me, is the best translation so far. Despite the fact that he was not an Arab-speaking person, but he captured meanings that, for me, are fascinating. Because of his, you know, studentship with Rashid Rida and all of that, and all of the learning that he did from the traditional schools, and therefore he was able to really capture the language and understand a lot. Yeah.
Also, he would have had a feel for Arabic, you know, Hebrew, so he wasn't completely foreign to Arabic, for one thing. For another thing, I'd like to recommend that people, if you try to learn Arabic, our languages are taught all wrong. They're taught by grammar, they're taught by the rules. You have to try to repeat, you have to try to supposedly lively discussions with people in a language you don't even know. It just takes a lot of time and it's too confusing. The best way to learn Arabic, or at least to start learning it, is to read the Quran, because there's so much that recurs there. The easiest way to start for non-Arabic natives is to start with the Quran. Forget the grammar, forget the Arabic language lessons, etc. And could I also ask you, I've heard it said that in Jannah there won't be any Quran.
There won't be any Quran?
Yes.
Why?
I don't know. I'd like to ask you.
I have never heard anything.
Unless
about
we're...
What do you mean by Quran? To read Quran?
I'm still trying to figure it out. That she heard it from someone.
There is no Quran in Jannah.
Maybe it's because you don't need the Quran, that you're right there with Allah and you're speaking to me. It wasn't Sister Zainab who said that. That wasn't her idea. It was from somebody else.
Yeah. You mean a printed Quran, a printed book?
No, the Quran
originally, by the way, is not a printed book. The Quran originally is an oral tradition. So Allah will make us forget the Quran? Why? I mean, there is no...
No, not forget, but just...
Yeah.
So it would be superseded in Jannah, which would make sense. If you've got Allah, you don't... If he's right there, all around...
Then you don't need the Quran.
Maybe, but you haven't heard that. It's intriguing, though, isn't it?
No, that's something that you said.
I mean, you have it from someone. Yeah, it wasn't your idea.
Well, I don't know.
It's the question. I'm just wondering about even the question itself.
Yeah.
Why do we ask that question?
That is important too. Like, what? Sometimes we ask.
Until I heard you quote say somebody else.
Yeah. Sometimes we ask questions about things that are irrelevant to our time. Like, you know, in Jannah was, my girl the other day was saying, in Jannah, would we be able to play soccer?
That's a good question.
Much better than
the question.
So I told her, yeah, well, I don't know exactly, but in Jannah, you have everything you ask for. So you love to play soccer? Yeah, okay, so in Jannah, you will play soccer, for sure. Okay, how about fishing? She said, can we fish? And I said, okay, yeah, sure, as well. You can also fish. So Allah will make fish and rivers, and He will. If you ask, He will. If that's something that you want. So what we know about Jannah, like sometimes we think about Jannah in terms of our human material sense. But the Jannah is something that the Prophet ﷺ said, فِيَا مَا لَعَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ. There is no eye that had ever seen anything like that, or hearing that had ever heard anything like that. So it is very different. Yes, the Quran is talking about tents and palm trees and so forth, but that is something for the Arabic language. You see, the Arabic language, traditional one, does not have spaceships or skyscrapers. I don't know, doesn't have this. So it is talking about tents and so forth. Tents made out of pearls and gold, and but that is just to get us to think that there is something, you know, out of this world, but not necessarily that, like we see, as you're talking about tents and camels and so forth. We're not talking about that, you see. So sometimes we think of that.
I have a
question.
Could you please just summarize, if someone asking you about the personal reflection of the Quran, and he or she asking for guidance, how do we reflect? And this is our personal reflection. I know you've discussed this through different, but if you try to summarize the main points that to guide that person, if we are asking people to reflect on the Quran, so in this case, of course, and especially we have to have in mind if they don't have Arabic. So in this case, do we tell them that don't reflect and leave this to the scholars who are, of course, have knowledge to understand the Quran, or we encourage people to reflect?
Well, I think it's a duty on every Muslim to reflect upon the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Don't they reflect upon the Quran? He's not talking about the scholars. He's talking about everybody. Disbelievers, in fact. He's talking in the sense that disbelievers have to reflect upon the Quran. أَفَلَا تَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالِهَا. Don't they reflect on the Quran, or their hearts are locked? أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالِهَا. So basically, if you don't reflect on the Quran, this is a sin, really. Like, you have to reflect, this is a duty. When you reflect on the Quran, just my humble recommendation to anyway, one of them is to be practical. You ask, what does this mean in my life? What do I get from this in my life?
So we reflected today upon Surah Al-Kahf. Okay, so this believers in the cave or the two friends having the dialogue. Okay, when I look at the dialogue between the believer and the disbeliever, what do I do with this in my life? Oh, so he had a dialogue with him. Okay, so my disbeliever friend that I'm trying to make da'wah with, I will actually get into this dialogue. How did he do the dialogue? He started by saying, أَكَفَرْتَ بِالَّذِي خَلَقَكَ مِنْ تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ. You disbelieve the Lord that created you from dust and then from a sperm. So basically he went through the, they call it the creation argument, if you wish. So you say, okay, this is one argument that I could benefit from this dialogue, the creation argument. And then the blessings argument, the favors argument. He told him, he gave you gardens, he gave you this. Okay, so this is one thing too. So maybe I could approach my friend by telling him or her, this is the, God has given you a lot. You know, God could have made your life very difficult, but, and this and that. So perhaps I should reflect practically. What does this mean practically? Even when you read about the hereafter or about the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a meaning in your life, practical meaning. So when you read that Allah is merciful, think about mercy and think about how you can be merciful. When you read that Allah is al-Razzaq, Allah al-Razzaq bil quwwati al-Mateen, Allah is the provider with all the force and the Almighty. Okay, then I think about if Allah is the provider, maybe I could rely on Him in a better way. I would put my trust in Him. He is the all provider. So I learn something practical or for the sake of my own heart when I read the Quran. I ask, what does this mean to me and my life? Rather than thinking, as Surah Al-Kahf again is mentioning, rather than thinking about were they three or five or seven, what were their names, and what kind of dog did they own, and what kind of cave, was it a cave, was it really a rock, was irrelevant. This is irrelevant. And sometimes we read about paradise and hell, and we don't think about our deeds. We think about details, as are we going to have TV there, are we going to have this. There's no need for that. We just think about what you can do and in a practical way when you reflect upon the Quran. So, yeah.
Well, my understanding of tadabbur reflection is just when I read, try to read tafsir, we have so many scholars, so when you read, you have your own questioning of that tafsir, and then you go search, and you try to go from scholar to scholar. That's something that will help you answer your own question that it came up while you're reading a tafsir. Maybe it's not for you convincing, and then you find it in another tafsir. So I find this is more tadabbur, instead of just taking it as is from one scholar and just go run by it. I run with it. And when I think about the time of the Sahaba when they really understand Arabic very well, and then they have words that they came across that they thought about it. This is when they did, the tadabbur, and then they went to the Prophet, and then they clarified for them. So this is how I look at it.
Yeah, Jazakallah khair. That's another advice that's very good. Like if you look at the tafsir and you're not convinced with what the scholar is saying, it's just an opinion of a person. It's an understanding. It's just a fiqh, not really. There is a difference between the Quran and the tafsir of the Quran. These are two different things. The Quran is high up there. Any tafsir is a reflection. So when you look at the tafsir and you're not convinced or you think that there are gaps in that kind of logic, go to another tafsir and try to find that, and that is inflection, because every scholar will give you an angle. That is a very good way of doing this as well. And every translation, from my experience, now interested in English and Islam in the English language, I have a lot of fun sometimes opening different translations for some of the verses, because they reflect the backgrounds of the people, and they reflect, especially in some sensitive issues or verses that are the interpretation of which is controversial. I was reading the other day, الرجال قوامون على النساء, قوامون, قوامة. You know, the men have قوامة over women. What is this قوامة? So you will find that some tafsirs say men are the protectors of women. like Yusuf Ali and Pictol and all the subcontinent, they have this protection mentality, you know, men are protectors of women. You will find in the American kind of tafsir, like Irving and etc., you will find the financial support, like men are the supporters of women. In Irving, for example. So the qiwama here is financial, even though it is part of it, perhaps, but they look only at this. That's their interpretation. So in the American way, the qiwama is spending money. And then in the Saudi official translation, if you look at it, men have authority over women. That is the translation. الرجالُ قوامون على النساء, the translation, men have authority over women. So they think in terms of authority and all of that and all of this. Muhammad Asad, again, is very, very interesting because he's saying men are caregivers of women. Men care for women. I think caring is a more meaningful way of looking at qiwam. Because qama yaqumu qamat al-ummu ala awladiha, the woman takes care of her children. Allah is qayyum. Allah is a caregiver. It's not about authority. Of course, he has all authority, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the qayyum, the qayyumiyya, that he is caring for us, he is sustaining us. He is, but sustaining it does not have to be necessarily financial. So part of the reflection for those who are English speaking, perhaps, to look at the different translations and sometimes the different languages. You know, when you open, I read a bit of French, so when you open the French translations, sometimes you find the difference between the French and the English very clear in the translation, because I mean the French are just, you know, they're different. So anyway, so that is some part of the reflection. It's all Quran anyway. Yes.
May I say something about the reflection itself? It's again also I guess there is difference between, as you said, between tafsir and the Quran. The Quran, when you spend your time reflecting on the Quran and taking that journey with the Quran, it's different. It's much different than taking that same journey with the tafsir. But let me say something exactly. I remember the first time our Sheikh asked us to reflect, and at that time it was Surah Al-Mulk, and he said you have to forget about all the tafsir or all everything. If you don't have the the Arabic as your language, you can use the translation and that's it. And then you reflect, try to read, listen, spend your live with the surah itself, and spend that time only with the surah, Surah Al-Mulk, for example. You can read and reread the surah many times. But every time you recite, you listen, maybe you will have some thoughts or questions. But the questions is just because of your recitation, because you are reflecting really upon the Quran. And in this case, maybe you write your question. You try to have a notebook or something. Write your questions, your thoughts, your ideas, but try to go back and forth again. Even maybe ask us for 30 times to review and recite the surah. That kind of experience, after we finish really reading, reciting, and going back and forth with that surah, it's really, it wasn't, we didn't only stick with the Surah Al-Mulk, but it took us to the whole Quran. Because immediately you are thinking about, okay, تبارك الذي بيده الملك, you have the موت, your hayat, and many other words. So this is one thing. Then after we finish our reflection, he said, now, if you want to go back to certain tafsir, go with the tafsir that maybe they use more tafsir al-Qur'an bil-Qur'an, because also you have different levels of the classical. At that time, you are comparing also your own reflection from one side with the other mufassir. And it guides you to go back to the Quran. So if we have the main point, the point that we start with and we end with is the Quran, so we will not be busy with the tafsir, but we will use it as some kind of as istinas, something that it maybe it helps us to understand specific, yes, specific issues. So
Zakallah,
I don't know what you think.
No, I totally agree. I agree because reflecting upon the Quran, but as you said, like you have to have the language skills in order to do that. But reflecting upon the Quran, and especially as a whole, gives you a balance of what Islam is about, really. Because sometimes you get into the tafsir, somebody is so fond of fiqh or so fond of the language or so, it takes you as if Islam is about fiqh or as if Islam is about the linguistic evidence. And that is not true. But the Quran gives you the balance of everything. You see, the Quran is talking about the hereafter in a lot of times, and talking about the stories of the Prophet from different angles. That is very important. When the Quran stresses something, then it is important. And when the Quran mentions something very quickly, then it is not important. That balances actually our understanding, because oftentimes we think about certain things that the Quran is mentioning in a very general way, and we make them central in Islam, even though the Quran is Islam. This is the message of Islam. And of course, the Prophet is an explainer. We sent you the book so that you illustrate. The Prophet is an illustrator. So sometimes we take one part of the Sunnah and just make Islam about that part. And that is not true. When we think about the rest of Islam or the rest of the Quran, then the Quran gives us that balance between what is important and what is less important. So I agree, but of course you have to have the language skills in order to do that. And that kind of tafsir is new, that in terms of tafsir for scholars, without looking at previous tafsirs. The first person that I know of who did that was Sheikh Muhammad Abdu. In his tafsir, in the introduction, as Rashid Duda is putting it, he is saying that I will attempt to have my own reflections on the Quran without going back to other tafsirs. But that level of scholarship is also like an advanced level. This is advanced scholarship in tafsir. But then other scholars followed suit in some areas. They didn't go so much to Ibn Ashur, for example, in his Tahrir wa Tanwir. He did not go so much to the previous scholars. He had his own reflections on the language, but that is a different level of approaching the Quran for scholarship. Okay, let's take a final question and then we'll take a break.
I don't speak Arabic. Only Arabic I know what I learned from Quran. So what I find very frustrating is how come you have these people that are scholars, but yet you can take one word and have so many different like translations of the same word. It's very frustrating for us English speakers because how do I know who to believe?
As an English speaker, and I guess as an American, I think you guys have to have a what do you guys call it? A user book or a manual. Manual, yeah, that's the American word. You have to have a manual with everything. And if it doesn't come with a manual, it's useless. Then you open the manual and you go by, and I really appreciate that for the American civilization. But the human nature is much more flexible than that, messy than that. Like not just messy, it is like the Quran by nature is supposed to be open to interpretations. Because human beings, this is not a manual. The tafsir is not going to be a manual for you. The tafsir is a reflection on the Quran based on the space and time of the reflector himself. It is not necessarily a specific manual for how to do things. Like perhaps it's frustrating because of your you know pragmatic nature as American. Okay, what do I use this for? No, but this is not how it is. The word authority, despite the fact that we all laughed at it, could be useful for some societies or some cultures or whatever it is. I don't know. Maybe some people look at men-women relationships this way. And the word protection that some people from a different culture looked at it could also apply, you know, that the man-woman relation is a protection relation. And the word care, could you find it more suitable to your, you know, worldview, perhaps, that you see, so the Quran has to be open for interpretation, and that's why perhaps the word qawwamuna, not necessarily, it is an Arabic word that is very flexible, and the Arabic language is like that. For every Arabic dictionary, if you open any Arabic word, you will see 5, 6, 20 different meanings for the same word. And that is not supposed to be confusing. This is why the Quran, from my perspective, is revealed in Arabic. So that it's open to tafsirs. It's open to those who want to do protection, and those who want to do care, and those who want to do authority or whatever, and so forth. So that we can live different times and different circumstances in ways that are compatible and congruent with the general feeling of Islam. Nobody will come with a tafsir of that particular word that is opposing to what Islam is about. But it's all within a certain range, you see. So I think there is a wisdom behind that the Arabic language of the Quran could bear different tafsirs and different wujuh, they call it in that tradition, different faces, different ways.
I have a question. When we talk about tadabbur, is there an aspect of muhasaba, muraqaba that one is referring to when the Quran says tadabbur? Because, it depends upon what you are seeking. If you are definitely seeking a decision on a hukum or a matter, then obviously you're seeking a tafsir based on fiqh or based on linguistics. That's going to be helpful. But when it comes to personal reflection, would it be a correct understanding that the word tadabbur could refer to muhasaba or muraqaba as to how it can relate to me as self-analysis, basically?
Yeah, of course, that is a great door to reflection as well. It's the door of muhasaba. La aqsim biyawm al-qiyamah wa la aqsim al-nafsi al-lawama, the soul that blames itself. That muhasaba is through that. When you read the Quran, you see, where am I from this?